that thing over there. It's that one. It's that one, it's that one, it's that one. And then everybody else who doesn't have a fursuit are still considered furries. Everybody either wants one. The entire convention is based on everybody with a common interest. Okay, so just because you don't have a fursuit, can't afford one, you're too little, it doesn't really matter. Everybody's here to have fun, like to enjoy the suits, whether they have one or not. They have a really awesome tail like she does. Did you make that?
Yeah.
See? That's a fursuiter in the making right there. That's a fursuit maker in the making.
Show us your tail.
Yeah, show them the tail. Show them the tail. You have to move around the pillar because it's really annoying.
Oh, that's cool. You did that.
She made that. How old are you?
Girl.
I'm 12.
She's 12 years old.
Yeah. You go, girl.
Suits that are based on they have an upper body or they have a lower set. So someone will wear a pair of shorts and they'll have a full like upper body of fur. Or the exact opposite. They'll wear a pair of pants and they'll have just leggings. Oh, that we already went over that.
Well,
the opposite.
There's a girl that's walking around she's wearing regular clothes from the waist up or waist down. She's a centaur.
Yeah. Okay. So like that. So you have one set of one piece of clothing, whether it's the top or the bottom. And then the rest of it is fur. So if I were to wear a shirt, you would see fur from the shirt down. If I were to wear a pair of pants, you would see a pair of jeans, and then you would see fur from the waist up. So that's what a three-quarter is, if you guys know that. I have a whole list of things here. Fursuit heads are based, like, it depends on the maker. Everybody has their own specific, I guess, trademark. Okay, my makers have the suits that I've owned all have different trademarks. Whether their heads look the same, like because they use the same style for every suit, but all the suits look different. So, for example, Mischief Makers about 2 years ago, they just changed their style. And you can tell it was a Mischief Makers a couple years ago because it's the taco bun. So if you flip it upside down, hey, a taco! Who's hungry? It's not Tuesday, sorry. So this is a Mischief Maker suit. Okay, the entire thing. They're actually really, really, like, significantly cheaper than most makers. So you're not going to spend as much as a lot of other places, like don't have cacti. Shh, sorry, don't have cacti. if you have a donut cacti suit, then that's awesome. You know, you spent a lot of money. Same thing with fursuiting. These makers are really, really well known, and their suits are of amazing quality, as far as I know. I don't own anything. I've owned a fursuiting suit, and I sold that one just recently that lives up in Oakland now. So, first thing about fursuit heads is that your vision is very, very limited. Depending on the maker. So, like with the glasses, his eyes are kind of like straight out. So how good is your vision? Go like this. So that's your vision? See, his vision is absolutely amazing. What about the center? You have a blind spot?
No.
You don't have a blind spot. So you can look straight ahead and still focus on me.
Yeah.
Okay. As opposed to this one, so you see this right here. This is a blind spot. Can you see this? What about this right here? Can you see my hand? She can't see it. That's a blind spot. So you have the blind spots out here, and then you have the blind spot right here. So when you see people that have the suits, like the gap, like in between, they have to walk like this. Because if they do it this way, your eyes are only going to focus in one direction. You're going to become one eye dominant, and then when you take that thing off, your vision going straight ahead is going to look blurry, and then they're going to walk around weird. Just because their focus is this way and not straight ahead. So that's why with those gaps, I prefer to walk this way, so that way it still balances your eyes. Some other people, some other makers like his, you can actually see, so your vision is actually more, like, it's better. The next thing that I wanted to talk about was, like, actually, like, the actual dexterity of fursuiting. I skipped the part. Never mind. Yeah, so vision and dexterity, so you don't want to overdo it. Like, how many of you guys have never suited before? How many of you have actually suited before, besides the people who are suiting right now? So you guys have. You put on a full suit, a completely full suit like mine. Okay. These things can get really hot, if you guys don't know that already. Has anybody ever told you, like, what the temperature is inside your suit? Does anybody know? It can get in the 110s to 120s, depending on how much foam and how much, like, padding and how much stuff you actually have going on. People who have, like, LEDs, they have to carry a battery. How hot do you think that gets when you actually wear it for a while? It'll get nice and toasty in there. It's like a sauna, really. So you want to work out in your suit. I mean, go for it.
Are there cooling off points?
There are. Yeah. There are some makers that actually, they actually have put fans in the muzzle or, like, above. There are some people that actually put vents, like, over the fur or under the fur, but they actually have vents so the heat can exfoliate, I guess the word is important. Yeah. They go out, they just leave the body, so you have a little bit better ventilation. I know that one for all suits, he incorporates fans in the muzzle, so that way you have a small battery, I think it's like 2 AA's or something like that, and you can use that, and the fan will blow in your face, and then I guess they have a vent going somewhere else. So you can actually suit for a while. There's also cooling packs online, like cooling vests, neck bands you can freeze, headbands you can freeze. I've seen a lot of those, like the easy cool stuff. I have a friend of mine who's actually here right now. His name is Corbin. He has that vest, so ask him about it and ask him, like, give him the information or ask him about the information about it.
I have two.
Yeah.
Awesome.
There you go. So they're actually really cool. I mean, they freeze really, really easily.
Yeah.
I mean, you can put them in an ice chest and they'll freeze. It's amazing.
Less than 4 hours. Huge difference.
Yeah. So you can suit for 4 hours as long as you're not running like a crazy person like I am. I'm pretty hyper, so that doesn't really do anything for me. Different types of styles. So you have the toonie vision, or the toonie eyes, the 3D toonie eyes, and then you have the realistic eyes. So I don't think I see any realistic ones in here. But you have, I don't see any toonie non-follow me eyes either.
Oh, I have.
There you go. There's one over there. So that is the regular standard toonie eye suit. Okay?
Oh, there it is.
So here. This is your basic toonie-eyed character, okay? So the reason why they call them 3D follow me eyes is because 3D like toonie eyes is because if you turn your head, you'll actually get the illusion that they're still looking at you, which is actually not good, which is why I got that. So mine has the 3D toonie eyes. So no matter which way you look, it gives you the effect that it's following you.
Oh,
so it's
cool.
Still looking.
Yeah, that is cool.
Everybody looks like my head's looking at them, and then, you know, there's like 20, 30 people in here.
Oh,
like, why is it staring
really
at me?
Cool.
How you stare at 30 people at the same time? And then you have the glass, like, realistic eyes. It's what they call tear duct vision. So the realistic eyes are actually, like, made of some kind of glass. Or I've never owned one of those things.
Resin.
Yeah, there you go. So it's made out of resin and stuff like that, and the actual vision isn't through the glass. I think some actually do that. I think it's in like one or two. You can, but I think it's like really, really hard. It's a process. But what they is the tear ducts are your vision. So you have the glass eyes, and then they look through the tear ducts just off to the just on the inside of it. So, and that vision, that vision is really, really limited because the tear ducts are about this big. So you have very, very little vision. So if you see one and you want to hug it, please act first. Let's see. Okay, so wearing a full suit, the body temperature is really important. So we're going to go into basic stuff like hydration is number one. Drink water. Sometimes Gatorade, because electrolytes are actually good for you too.
Wall of shame.
Way to be on time for boot camp. Fail. So, water is really, really important. I mean, if you've never suited before and you want to suit, don't overdo it. You can overheat really, really fast if your body's not adjusted, is not accustomed to the amount of temperature that you're going to be enduring. So, like for me, when I first started suiting, I had very little ventilation. My head was a full foam base head, so I had no ventilation whatsoever. Breathe in through the mouth, and there's nowhere else for it to escape. So if you wear it for like 15 minutes, you're going to start sweating, which is why people like put their head on last, and they literally run up kill because they want to get in as much suiting as they possibly can before they start to die. We're going into time management. So like I said, spread it apart, spread your suiting apart. Fursuit lounges for a reason. Headless lounges for a reason. So we require people to turn off their cameras. They if they don't belong in there, then they shouldn't be in there. Unless it's a fursuit handler. You can use the fursuit lounge or you can use your rooms. If you're going to pass out, you're about to pass out, take off your head. I mean, your safety is more important than the magic. Hands down. I went through that one time, and I was like, never again, because I was dying, and they had turned off the first who's first in the elevator thing, just because of the magic. They don't do that anymore, in a lot of conventions, which is actually unfortunate. But if you're actually like feeling that you're gonna pass out, then just take off your head, because the last thing you want is to wake up with your head off and then everybody doing this.
Has that happened to you?
No, it's not happened to me, but I've seen it happen. I mean, you don't want to wake up and, you look with one person, you see one person standing next to you, and you pass out, and you wake up, and everybody's surrounding you laughing at you. I mean, I'd get everybody if I could. But, so it's really important to, spread out the time. And plus, if you wear your suit for a long time, eventually it's going to stink. So you want to spread out throughout the entire weekend, because some conventions go for 4 or 5 days. This is only 3. So, further confusion up in San Jose is 5 days. Starts on Thursday, goes from Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday.
Whoa.
Awesome.
People get there on Wednesday, and then you can register on Wednesday. And then they have a pre-rave kind of thing, and then everything kicks off on Thursday. That con is smaller than Anthrocon, which is the number one con, but it goes longer, which is really weird.
So how do you wash them? How do you get the smell out?
We're going to get into that next one. So the next thing, Febreze is one of those. But no, Febreze is not the number one go-to. Okay, so the next thing we're going to go to is type of stuff you wear underneath this. I have what's called a combat gear. It's a type of Under Armour that Nike uses. So this is what I use. I have a white pair on right now, but this is a combat gear. This is actually really, really good. This is very light. It's very ventilated because it's not like full fabric. It's a mesh. You can still see through it. I found this out just recently. This is I've been using I found this out less than a year ago, and these are a lot. I think these are a lot better than. What my next thing is the Under Armour stuff. So the Under Armour is a lot heavier, and they have two different brands. They have cold gear and heat gear. That in itself is, impossible. Then you gotta find the right kind. So the combat of the heat gear and the cold gear are designed to either keep you dry or keep you like wet. So you want like the fabric itself in Under Armour either emits sweat away from you or keeps it within yourself. If it emits sweat away from you, it's trying to keep you cool and dry, as opposed to your body using its own sweat to keep yourself cool. So that one that I just showed you was to keep sweat from emitting away from the body, because if you have your sweat emitting away from your body, it's going to get all over the next set of fabric, which is your suit. The next thing you know, someone's hugging you, and you're like, because you're all wet, and that's like gross. Where else are you going to get, how else are you going to get wet? Right? So the combat gear, I believe, is made out of like a type of stainless. The Under Armour gear, I'm not so sure about, but the fact that it's heavier and it's not as ventilated, I actually prefer the combat gear. You can get combat gear anywhere. It's not as popular as Under Armour, so it's easier to find. And they're cheaper too, actually. Under Armour is a really big trademark. And if anybody's ever bought Under Armour before, it's like $30 for, and then another $25 for the box. Combat gear, you can spend $20 for a set. So, the next thing is your socks. Yes, my socks match my suit. Okay, these you can get anywhere as well. These are dry fit high top socks. These are wonderful. They're kind of thick, but that's what they are. They're dry fit. So, I have two pairs of these. Wonderful. My feet will never like actually sit in water or snap in sweat. That's where all your sweat goes. These things are dry. These things are like, if you guys ever worn dry feet, like dry socks before, the dry feet socks, dry fit socks. No? Yes? I wear them for like weddings that I go to and things like that. The places where you're gonna actually wear things where your feet don't get a lot of ventilation. Your feet stay dry with these. They're wonderful. Yeah, it's true. And your hand paws will get wet. You'll take them off, like in the fursuit lounge, and put them back on, and they're like, dude, your hands are all wet. You never want to take something off after 2 hours when you're sweating in it, and then you got to put it back on like 30 minutes later. It's really, really gross. I've done that before. That's just, like, if you ever see someone do that, like they take it off, and you see them go, ew. Even from their own sweat. I've done that. It's the same thing with your hands, your feet, I mean, your head. Your head's the worst, though, because then you feel it's like all cold and wet. Okay, so we went under Under Armour, going past. Okay, so the next thing we're going to go over is the 6-2-1-8 rule. I added one on there. The 8 is a new thing that I'm trying to implant into this whole set. So, 6 hours of sleep every night or day. If you're nocturnal, good for you. Whatever, you're going to stay there for the rave and then 2 o'clock you're going to 6 hours of sleep is really, really important. At least 6 hours. I went to bed at midnight. I woke up at like 9. So it's plenty of sleep for me. 2. At least 2 full meals a day. Your body runs on fuel. Where do you get fuel from? You eat. You drink water. You do electrolytes. I'm in school for nursing, so it's kind of important coming from, you know, medical doctors. Okay? A minimum of at least 1 shower a day. I do 2 showers. When I left this morning, I shower. When I get home, I'm going to shower. When I leave tomorrow from my girlfriend's house, I'm going to shower. When I get home to her house, I'm going to go to sleep. I wake up, get another shower. It's really important to shower because no one wants to smell a musky person. Okay? 8. 8 cups of water each day. Okay? That's what the 8 is. The military requires you to drink 8 full ounces. What is it? Okay. 8 cups of fluids. That's 30 milliliters. So is preferred. I'm still trying to implement. That's why it's preferred. It's not actually in the thing yet. Okay, that's really, really important. Let's see. Fursuits generally, you see, like they generally have someone with them. So, do you have a handler? There you go. Can you both stand up? So you see the fursuiter, right? You have the person standing next to her is a handler. Okay, that's the go-to safety person, you know, sometimes they'll be like, oh my God, can I have a picture? And then they'll give it to that person, and then you can take a picture with them, and then you can, hopefully you'll hand the camera back, and carry on about your day. Okay, so, so is anybody here with a suitor that is not in suit? Okay, all of you guys are considered handlers. You're the first suitor safety. I have, like, outstanding vision, and I've been doing this for years, so I don't really walk around with one, and they can't keep up with me anyway. I don't sit still for very long unless I'm doing something like this. If you notice, like, I keep walking back and forth. I still don't sit still. So, I don't like sitting still when I'm in suit, because if you sit still, then all your body's going to do is just fade, and it's just not me. For the fursuit handlers, safety is the number one. So, they have to be weary. They have to be aware of their fursuiter's vision, their ears, their horns, anything that's like, if they're 6 feet tall and they have horns that go up to 7 feet, do you think they're gonna actually like realize that their horns are gonna come out of the door? No, right? So you don't get clunk, and then your horn's gonna fall off, and then you're gonna get all mad because the handler didn't tell you, hey, duck. You know, so it's really important to like understand the height, distance and vision and things like that. Protection from the overzealous fans. At some point in your fursuiting life, you have run into some person that goes like this, oh my God! And then they tackle you. And the first thing you're gonna do is get away from me. I'm sure at one point you either have experienced or you were going to. I get at least one every time.
Or you just tackle it.
Oops. No, don't do it. And they're also, the handlers are also their timekeeper. So generally if you're in suit, you definitely lose track of time. There's no possible way you can be in the middle of suiting and go, oh, because you can't see your watch for one. It's per 30. So you have to understand that it's like people who have suited for a long time, you're gonna lose track of time regardless. So that's what the handler is also for. So if you guys both have plans to go to a panel and you're in the middle of suiting and then you have no idea what time it is, then you're gonna either miss that panel, or you're gonna miss that event, or you're gonna, you know, miss out on whatever it is you're doing. Also, the timekeeper is really important because, like, hey, you've been suiting for the last 2 hours. How do you feel? You know, if they're gonna be like, oh, I'm fine, you're like, yeah, you know, like, let's go get some water or something because you've been running around like a madman for the last 2 hours and you haven't drank anything and you're not following the 6-1-2 April, right? So it's really, really important. Translation. A lot of suits don't speak in suit. Who doesn't speak in suit? See all these people? You know what that means? They're gonna be doing this. You're gonna be like, green? there are specific, like, you have to understand the pantomime language. So, I mean, obviously, if they're doing this, then they're choking. If they're doing this, then they have to go to the bathroom. And having zippers in the back, like mine, it gets kind of complicated. Because you can't, like, I really have to go. But I can't read. So you have to, like, okay, here you go. For those people that don't, you really have to understand, you have to ask them, you know, they're going to be like, yes, they're going to be like, no, they're going to be, don't do that, they're going to be, like, it's really hot, let's, you know, take your head off. Pantomiming is really important. Basic, general hand motions that are quite obvious. If someone doesn't understand it, then obviously that person hopefully will tell you, like, instead of saying, like, what does that mean? I don't know what that means. Hopefully they'll say, I want to take my head off. Let's go. Then, hey, let's, it's obviously some kind of emergency that they want to go sit down, they need to go relax, they need to go get some water, they need to go to the bathroom, whatever. different types of communication. There's not only pantomime and regular conversation, but there's also squeakers. Sometimes they overdo it. Most of the time they overdo it. And sometimes they don't. Hopefully the panel that I hosted yesterday, the squeak panel, will actually take my rules. And don't overdo it. If you're walking around like just in regular clothes and you have no tail, nothing furry related on, you look like a normal person, and someone says, "Hey, how are you?" and you go, "Squeak." Like, okay, you're dumb. I'm gonna go this way. I'll come back with your gun squeak. It's not a super bad thing. It's just frowned upon, because if you do that, then not only are you not being a normal, I'm not saying like a normal person, because nobody in here is normal. You can't define normal. it's going to make you look like you're too into it. Hey, look, cool shooter. No clothing. Hey, so that's a plantigrade suit. Like mine. I don't see any digigrades in here. Is there a digigrade in here? Oh, there you go. Can you stand up? A digigrade, it gives it that, like, that, the illusion of mind waves. So give it a walk around. So if you look at the legging on the back, she has the calves that look like, hind legs.
Oh, that's right.
That's a digigrade suit. Those are generally more expensive than the regular ones, like these ones. So hopefully the squeaking is kept to a minimum. I overdid it, and then I stopped doing it because I overdid it, and then everybody else started doing it, and then they overdid it, and then it just killed it for a lot of people. So the last thing for handlers is obviously the photographer part, which we already went over. I didn't realize we were going to go over this super quick. Is there any questions so far?
Cleaning.
What about props?
Props. We'll go over cleaning after props.
Okay.
Got it. Props. You stand up. You see his glasses? That's a prop. Any kind of props you want to bring. You can walk around with a backpack or a kitty thing that looks just like your suit. You can, anything can be used as a prop. You can carry around a shoe and then throw it at people and be like, that's funny. A friend of mine, Axton, walks around with his giant steak.
Oh, yeah.
And he just hits you with it. I've hit people with pillows before. Just, like, grab a pillow out of the lobby and then stack people with it.
No.
That's a prop. Anything. Anything can be used as a prop, as long as it's not a deadly weapon. Other than that, I think you guys should be fine. Anything fluffy, your tail, you can use your tail as a prop. If you have a long enough tail, you can walk around with it and hit people with that. So it's anything that you're carrying with you is a prop. Anything you can wear on your head, hat, glasses, earrings, like they can be part of the suit, they can be not part of the suit. Some certain badges are props. There's a friend of mine who walks around with a giant sign that says Fursuit Simulator. Because he has, like, Mickey Mouse gloves, and he has this face thing that he puts on the mask or whatever, and then walks around like that, and he's just, I'm simulating. Instead of actually putting one on. It's actually quite funny. I don't know if he brought it, though. So, yeah, props can be used as, you can have anything as a prop. Cleaning. Clean, cleaning, cleaning.
Oh.
Please clean your suit. Pretty please, with sugar on top and a cherry. Pretty please. Cleaning is very, very precise. You have to. There's different ways of doing it. There's different types of washers and dryers and hang-up dries and bathtub washes and things like that. We'll go over all of that. I think I have a fursuit maintenance panel sometime later that goes over all that stuff.
Yeah.
But cleaning can be, I clean my suit. I clean the hands, my tail, and my bodysuit in a regular washer. As long as you turn it inside out and use cold water on a delicate cycle, gold.
Oh, delicate cycle.
Delicate cycle is really important.
Yeah.
Because if you do it on a regular cycle, then the actual spin dial in the center, even the old washers, even the spin dial in the center can pull forever. Because you can rip holes in your suit. I've actually gotten clothes like with holes in them, like I've ripped them in the washer. People have lost socks in the washer. Like it's that sock monster, you throw it in there and it just eats it. So cold water, delicate cycle. Do not put it in the dryer. Don't. It eliminates the risk of if you put it in the dryer, you have to put it on a no-heat tumble dry cycle on delicate. If you put even the slightest amount of heat, you can't control the temperature, and like maybe you can in the new ones, in the new washer and dryers. But you run the risk of forgetting that you need to turn the heat off. The heat melts the plastic. This is plastic, it's not actual fur, it's plastic. So if you throw the stuff in the dryer and you leave it on any kind of heating cycle, it'll melt. My friend, my actual fursuit maker's mother threw his chupacabra in the dryer on a delicate cycle, and it melted his fur. It was like all matted, and it looked like you would like literally melt like seamed fur together, but like flat. So it actually looks like regular plastic instead of a fur plastic, a fabric. So he had to remake his suit. That wasn't even his like make. Someone else made it for him, and then it was destroyed, so he remade it because he makes these now. Coffee. The new dryers. A friend of mine has a new dryer, and he actually has like a setting for like very, very delicate. They're like the front-loading ones, and you can actually turn that off. I still wouldn't recommend using those either, because sometimes the dryers themselves, if you throw it in the dryer and you turn it on no heat, tumble like air dry, and you're curious on whether it's dry or not, so you open it and you check it, and oh, it's not. You close it, but you have to know if it's going to reset the dryer or not. My parents' dryer, it resets every time you open it, so you have to reset. So if you pull it out, you checked it, and you close it, and you just hit start again, you won't know if it's on heat or not. And then there goes the risk of damaging your suit, which is why I recommended not putting it in the dryer. The spin cycle alone is enough to dry it. You would brush it, like, I brush it from the legs up, because all the fur lays down. So you start from the legs up, so that way you can layer it, and that way it looks nice and pretty. Mine doesn't, because I didn't brush mine right away. I had to brush it this morning. So brushing is really important. I actually have a brush too. So
do you use regular soap or do you use wool light?
Wool light is the go-to for your fur. It smells really nice and it's really easy on the fur. It's really easy on like the smell and stuff like that. I use Tide. Tide seems to work because it has Febreze in it. And I use a little Tide Pods thing. So I'll let the water run, and then to a point where it's at that point where it's, you know, it's nearly full, there's still soap and stuff, like the actual Tide like little packet is broken. And then once everything's in there, then I'll put it in. So that way I know for sure that the pot itself broke. There's actually soap in there, and then the turn dial will actually be nice about it and then actually wash it. Being inside out is really, really important.
Any tips for white fur?
Same thing. Same thing. So this is a slicker brush. White fur, don't use bleach. Don't use bleach. It's bad.
And for the white fur, you want to add some borax to the wash. The borax will soften the water and help a little bit pull out that muck that gets into the white fur.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's a new word.
What about the
about
a
half cup of borax?
Oxyclean is good. We can use that. The bleach pen, I would not recommend.
Okay.
We'll go into like spot cleaning in a second too. So this is a slicker brush. Okay. These are designed to pull the undercoats of fur out. So if you do this, it's really rough. So you actually want to go the opposite direction, and it lays out flat. So I'll do it. And it didn't designed to pull the fur out so you're not shedding. So if you're shedding, then still it'll still pull the loose fur out, but it won't pull the actual fur that's still attached to it.
What about dry cleaning? What about dry cleaning?
Most dry cleaners do not know how to take care of these. I would, because dry cleaners, they steam stuff and they throw it in the dryer. They don't know how to clean it. They'll look at you funny. I've never been in there because I was told the same thing. Like, they'll look funny, like, how to clean this. And then you'll get it back and it's look like a completely like, icy. It looks like one of those plates. Please do not clean your suit with this. There's actually a trick that my sister taught me. My sister's not a furry at all. At all. But she has a mother, so she knows a lot about cleaning. She has a 1-year-old, and you know, the 1-year-old just knocks everything over. She actually gave me this idea that it's the same idea of blow drying your hair. You blow dry it, it'll come out nice and right? The same thing when you go is when you wash it. If you blow dry it, but you have to hold down that cool button. You can do it one of two ways. I use the blow dryer on a low setting, and I'm kind of at a distance. So as soon as like that air hits it, it's not as warm as it is when it left. So you're not like up in your scalp like drying your hair. You're super far away. So the air is actually cooler, but it's still slightly. It's like room temperature. So it'll help bring out the fur a little bit. It'll actually make it a little bit more fluffier. That's how I usually dry and brush my suits. I dry it from the bottom up and then brush it as I blow dry. You have to be able to multitask, so practice. That's how like my suits generally stay clean as far as like the vibrant colors and the white fur.
Wait, how old is that suit?
This is going on 2 years now. My last one was 5 years old and it looked just as good as this before I sold it. The only thing that was really damaged was the feet, and that's normal wear and tear.
Are you gonna cover feet? Are you gonna go over feet?
Yeah, I can. It's the feet are pretty easy. I use spot shot. I mean, you can throw it in the washer.
No, I mean the cleaning and making. Like, what do you do for the padding at bottom?
I don't make suits.
Oh.
Honestly, I don't know what type of fur they use. I think a fursuit maker, if there is one in here that can answer that better than I can, maybe this person.
I can't though, but what about using a comb to brush it out?
Is what kind of comb?
What?
What kind of comb?
Like a regular comb. Plastic comb? Yeah.
It depends on the fine. It depends on the fine, like, tooth. If you have it, if they're too spread out, you're not going to be able to get the layer. It's going to be just like, if you came out like out of a shower and your hair is like in like certain clumps, it'll look like that. If it's too fine, it'll pull it forever. So with these brushes, the slicker brushes, they have, like they're attached, but they have it by little people. So it looks like this. This way, you can break up all the matting, and it still won't pull. designed, if you actually brush a dog the correct way, then it'll, you notice that you pull fur out like crazy. If you do it the other way, it's not going to pull your fur out. It'll still have the same effect. Just make sure you do it because your fur is layered down there. So you want to actually start from the bottom up and then work your way up. Someone's just like, oops, coffee, or hopefully it's not coffee. I actually went to an event for autism speed up in El Toro a couple years ago, and then one of the kids had some kind of face paint or something on, and actually hugged my leg on the white where my other suit was. My old suit was a frost gray and then a white belly. They hugged my side and it was like a vibrant blue on the side in a few spots. So thankfully, I had spot shot and a rag with me, and I washed that off, and it came right out after 5 minutes. You actually have to read the directions, by the way. I went through 6 months using spot shot and didn't read the directions, thought I knew how to use it. I actually read the directions, and it actually works better. So read the directions first. Yeah, back.
Would you recommend using what's called a Siege teddy bear cleaner for cleaning small stains if you don't really want? If you really don't have the means to clean it fully or don't want to clean it fully?
The same thing. Spot shot, it's kind of like a Tide pen. If you have a Tide pen with you and you're wearing clothes and you drop spaghetti sauce on your shirt, mm-hmm. you use that Tide pen to do that little spot. Mm-hmm. Same thing with spot shot. Spot shot's the exact same design. It's not meant for big messes. I mean, it can, but it might take you a while. But the little stuff like that, it's a... Yeah, that's what the cleaners are for. Some hotels actually have washers and dryers. I've actually washed my suit in one of the washers and dryers, one of the washers before, and it was actually, it's just a regular washer. So I mean, you can do it that way if they have one.
What about woolite carpet cleaner?
Woolite. I think I use that. That's like a foam, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think it's more along the lines of big stains. And for thicker carpets. I used it on my suit once. It took forever to dry. Forever. Because when you spray it, it foams up and then it seeps in. And then you have to leave it there for 10, 15 minutes. You have to spray it, rub it in, leave it there for 15 minutes, get the stain out, and you gotta dry it. And then by then, the moisture's already seeped into your foam. And if you leave foam for too wet, wet for too long, then it grows moldy. And that's really, really gross. Probably just throw it away after that.
Basically using hydrogen peroxide to spray the inside.
Yeah, hydrogen peroxide, watered down alcohol is another good way. Just don't put it on right after. You might get high or drunk, whatever. Yeah, you might be seeing things for a while. Yeah, and then also, I don't know if you guys were here. Who was here last year? Were you guys here for my accident?
What accident?
Okay, so I did a front flip.
Oh.
Under the influence.
Oh.
over rotated, and then I broke my fall with my face.
Oh.
I broke my nose in two places. I broke both orbital sockets, both black eyes, and about $4,500 worth of surgery.
Holy
yeah, probably. So if you can imagine, if I broke my nose and my orbital sockets, I bled, right? Well, I was wearing that.
Oh.
Oh.
When I did that. So the foam broke my fall, and my doctors actually told me that that thing saved my life. Because after the MRI and the CT scan, they got a measurement, and my nasal cavity, my nasal bone, was 4 millimeters from being put in my brain.
Oh.
You don't want to die at a convention. You don't want to be that guy.
No, no.
You
went. No.
So, but when I went to the hospital, some friends of mine came out, and if you notice, there's no blood in here. There's no blood whatsoever. It's quite impressive. The blood's practically the hardest thing to get out, besides coffee. Baking soda. That's what that was. I don't know how, like, the process that they used for cleaning it. You can ask them. Kaylon and Chance the Fun Dragon are the guys that helped me out with that. So you can ask them the process on how they cleaned that and washed all of my blood out. So it actually probably came out a lot better than what it did when it went in. So any other questions about cleaning? It takes out in everything.
Okay.
The biggest thing about spot shot is why I always say white and a white cloth, because sometimes different colors will actually like fade. Like if you throw your clothes in the washer and it comes out brighter than you did when it came in. Like if you throw darks in with whites and then it's fader, your blue shirt fades into like a sky blue, like fur color. Then, I mean, obviously your color faded, right? Same thing with towels and rags. I mean, if it gets wet, sometimes it'll fade, and then you can actually brush off some of that color onto your suit. So that's why I emphasize using a white rag. I used a shirt at one time, and it came out darker, so I had to clean it again. Thankfully, it came out. But white little 8x8s or whatever, those white rags are what I prefer. And you can actually see the dirt come off too. So
yeah. Also, was told this by Oz Kangaroo, one of the things he uses to disinfect his fursuit is a combination of ice bowl alcohol, also known as rubbing alcohol, and imitation vanilla.
Imitation?
Yeah.
Vanilla made it smell better. That's cool. I think Frisbee does the same thing, actually. Because Frisbee literally smelled like vanilla for like 3 hours. I don't know how they do that, but that's really cool.
That's how they make rum normally, is with dip. Vanilla sticks into the alcohol itself.
That's why you don't want to use real vanilla extract. You want imitation vanilla.
Yeah. What's up?
Lysol. Yes,
Lysol. Inside, yes. Outside, no. I've heard some bad things about Lysol, and you don't want to overdo it.
Just for the inside, you turn it inside out and spray it?
You don't have to turn your paws inside out. I mean, if you can, then go for it. I mean, it's really hard to get those fingers right back in where they were.
What about for, like, the suit itself, like sleeves? And
yeah, turn it inside out. I've heard bad things about Lysol being put on top of the fur. Like, on the inside is like where all of your body connects to it, and your sweat gets on the inside of it, because it's all layered, it's not fur. So you can spray that, and that'll kill it. And then the same thing with your head. You don't want to sit there, like, it's like, oh, it's really dirty. Maybe a little more. Don't do that. It's really bad, and then it takes forever to dry, and I think that's actually bad for the foam itself. It's because there's only a small layer connecting from the head and then the foam on the, like, between the fur and where your head sits. So one little and then that's it. That's all you need.
There is something in Lysol that makes foam brittle.
There you go. So don't want to. Don't do that. Anything else? In the back.
You said about the water thing. I know they have like backpacks for like bicyclists that you just fill up with like so much water, and then they have a tube around your neck.
Yeah.
Do you think you'd be able to wear one of those under the suit and then have it come up through the head so you have water without having?
You can do that, but I think if you do it underneath, it'll heat the water up.
Okay.
And then what happens when you land your back?
Oh.
Your back pops, and then you're like.
Well, yeah, because it's like a backpack.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like,
I can tell you, we use those things in the Army, and if you have those under something, that water will get just as hot as the rest of you, and with our body armor and everything, we're rocking, 100, 200 degrees, And if you put ice in them, they're the most uncomfortable thing you can imagine. So.
Okay. I wore them in Navy too. I was in Afghanistan 2001.
I was just curious, how hot does the heads themselves get? Because I wasn't planning
just
on
the heads?
Just the heads.
My suit, I do what's called a party mode, where I just do head and hands, and I'll just walk around like a normal person.
Yeah.
That isn't as bad as wearing a full body, because the rest of your body is still able to emit the heat.
Okay.
So it's not just your head that's emitting heat, so it doesn't get as hot, your body doesn't feel as hot, but it still can get warm. So, not as many breaks, but, like, you know, you can take a couple. So, it's really based on your preference. But, honestly, I can run around with my head all day, and my head and hands all day, and not have a problem. Depending on, like, I would do a short-sleeve shirt. That's my party mode, is a short-sleeve shirt. Skin showing, like, skin is not a big deal to me. If it's showing or not, that's what party mode is. You're too drunk to put on the rest of your suit, so you want just your head and your hand. And you're like, oh, look, I'm a fursuiter. It's my, like, one quarter partial.
I remember reading that the idea that the majority of the heat escapes through your head is a misnomer, actually.
What?
No. That, like, 90% of the heat that escapes through your head is actually a misnomer.
It's a misnomer.
No, it's true.
Now, what the legend came from when they put the infrared cameras on fully clothed people, and what's typically not clothed is your head. So
yeah.
That's where the body heat escapes from, but if you're naked, most of the heat has to go from your armpits and chest.
Yeah. It's the same thing with, like, your feet, because your feet, like, if you notice, like, you spend all this time walking around, and, like all of your sweat, gravity pulls all of your sweat to your feet, which is why they emphasize washing your feet. It's because all of your sweat and all the bacteria that came off of your body is now in your shoe. So washing your feet is really important. But it's the same concept. Only, like, if it gets hot in there, it can get sweaty in there. If it's going to get hot up here, it's going to get sweaty up here. So, yeah, I can see that. I can see that, I'm not going to, like, say yes or no to, like, the whole heat thing. I mean, it's another thing to take into consideration. But with the rest of your body still exposed to the air, you're still being able to get that cool, like, that cool breeze, or, you know, your body's able to emit the heat away from your body in some way, shape, or form. If you're in a full suit, your body can't do that. So everything's going to go upward. Anything else? On any kind of suiting question, any suiting question. In the back.
To answer, what they put on the bottom of the suit, for inside feet, what they do is they put just regular fur, but if you're doing an outdooring kind of foot, they actually can use the plain black door mat, so they'll cut around.
They can do that, or they can do this.
Yeah, like that.
Nothing handles the floor better than your shoe. But that's why I wanted it this way.
And you don't slip on wet surfaces.
True. If you use the doormat, like I had my first suit had just the flat surface. I also had Heelys in my suit, in those feet.
Oh.
And if you try Heely on carpet, you're gonna get traction.
Nope.
So even if you try and stop, you're still going. Those things wear out. They also wear out really, really fast. Which is why, like, some people, they actually drag their feet, because their feet, they have those massive stompy paws and they can't lift them. So you're. That'll wear out the fabric. So that's why I prefer just doing it this way, because no one's gonna be like, hey, let me see your foot. I mean, they have the indoor paw option. My new suit's gonna have indoor paws, but they're also gonna have sandals. So sandals are like you guys ever like used a year ago to like the mall, and you see that little child play place where like has the little phone and the numbers on the inside of it. The sandals are made out of that same product, so they're actually made to like last. And you can put little Velcro, the band, the straps over it. You can strap that to your football and then walk around like an old person like sandals. And you can protect the fur underneath your feet.
Called EVA.
Yeah,
EVA.
Cool. Any other questions?
Is there a preference in type of shoe, like Converse or something else?
Something comfortable. I have really expensive shoes. These were $120. These are Nike Airs. These are Jordans. They were like, no, don't do that. I dance in this, so I need those. I also have a pair of Heelys for my other set of feet that I didn't bring. I've seen people use slippers. You can't really do a whole lot in slippers, and they get really gross. something comfortable, because you never know how long you're going to be in the suit. Tennis shoes are preferred. I know people that wear, like, high-top Converses. I know people that wear, like, regular Converses. And then there are some friends that actually use, like, the stompy feet, and they actually have, you can actually, they have enough room to actually put any kind of shoe on and then put their foot over it, or put their foot paw over their shoe. So, I mean, you could walk around in flip-flops and still have your stompy paws on, but you still have your feet in your gross.
Are your feet built onto those shoes?
Yeah, these ones are built in. So these are actually hot glued onto, or not hot glued, they're shoe glued. That's another thing too. Hot glue does not hold as well as you think. These feet paws are maybe 3 months old? No, these are younger. I went to TFF, I got them shortly after TFF, so it was in February. So these are, I got these in March. And I've already hot glued these on twice. Like the fur itself will actually the hot glue will actually come out, because when you run around, your feet get hot. When the glue gets hot, it melts, or it gets loose again, so it comes apart. We found out, or a friend of mine found out, Halon, he found out that shoe goo is actually really, really good. The only problem is it's flammable when it's wet. When it's like, you know, in that, you know, molding stage. So I didn't bring the shoe goo with me, but shoe goo holds it for ever. They actually use it on regular shoes, so it'll actually stick.
The hot glue, another reason why it won't last a long time is because it only has a certain amount of flexibility, especially if you're using it to your feet.
Mm-hmm.
It breaks that bond.
Yeah.
You can't stretch with it.
Yeah. So shoe goo is kind of like a rubber cement, but it's not rubber cement. I want to actually try that, though. I've seen rubber cement before, and I dumped it onto one of my parents' like little shoe holder things. I think it's still on there. I did that when I was like 12.
3M spray adhesive. Excellent.
What's that?
3M spray adhesive.
I've never seen that.
Super 77 or Super 90? Yeah.
Does you work well with pulling the fur down?
Shugu is really old to hold the fur onto the shoe.
Yeah, but some glue don't work well with material.
I did this a couple days ago, and it's been holding out pretty well. So when it comes to gluing fur onto the shoe, shoe goo is the way to go. Because the shoe goo, I read the label on the back. Always read directions, trust me. It protects the shoe, I guess. But what I read is like they actually use this on like regular shoes. It protects the shoe. I guess the shoe's like semi waterproof, so water doesn't seep in like inside of your foot. Shoe goo is what I would prefer. So it's the way to go. It might be a little bit more expensive, but it's definitely worth it if you want that.
So I would pass the actual shoe itself as a sole material.
Yeah.
So it's running shoes I put on because I've got a serum and I'm going to get it from metal. Put shoe goo on it, and about 2 years later, the sole was gone.